Good morning, Mexico. It's a great pleasure to join in this course. I would like to thank the invitation to organizing committee and especially to Professor Santa Maria. My talk, Present and Future of Brazilian Construction, is easy to speak about present but difficult about the future. And first, no disclosure about my talk, and I am not going to do any, you know, historical perspective of Brazilian Construction. I am going to give my own vision. I am not if it's the right one, but at least is what I can explain to you. But it's important to study a little bit the past to define the future. This is something that Confucius said, and this is obviously what you need to do. When you see first how is changing the Brazilian Construction, the first thing is to see how is changing the oncology surgery. And we move from the Halstead radical mastectomy to the modified breast mastectomy, and nowadays got this subcutaneous skin sparing mastectomy that allows to us to do better breast reconstruction. Obviously, in this century, it's not enough to do the breast cancer treatment. We need to do, you know, the treatment of all the sequela. We need to do this minimal effective treatment, keeping the quality of life. For that reason, we need to treat all the sequelas of this breast cancer treatment, the mastia, the deformity, the radiotherapy effect, and also, why not, the malapraxis and the lymphedema. When you see which are the differences around the world in regarding to breast reconstruction, you can find many arguments, but the two most important are the local sources and the surgeon experience and the surgeon preferences. And this is not fair because, you know, the breast reconstruction is something optional, and also we need to consider the patient preferences. When you see what is new in the breast reconstruction side or in the breast cancer to define this new paradigm, we can find many arguments like new anatomical concepts, the new breast cancer therapy, the new technology development. But the most important thing is the source patient information. And you can see here, for example, when you ask to Dr. Google, or when you ask it in 2012 regarding to breast reconstruction, you found at that time 1.5 million of places when you can find, you know, you could find information about reconstruction. When you ask the same question now, you can see that nowadays you can find 57 million of results. It means that the interest of the breast reconstruction among our patients increase a lot. And this is good. It means that our patients, they are fighting to get the best results. And this is what Angelina Jolie show us, you know, when she decided to do this prophylactic, you know, breast mastectomy. And that was a big revolution on that way. When you define, or you want to define the goals in surgical, in breast reconstruction, obviously to do breast reconstruction is something more than do a volume. You need to create a natural and permanent breast, and it's very important in that way to create harmonic volume, the right shape, the natural evolution, and the most important thing, the self-perception. And obviously with the minimal morbidity. This is why to do good breast reconstruction, you need to have good knowledge in physiology, in anatomy, in oncological knowledge, but obviously in reconstructive anesthetic principles. When you see the patient expectations, you can find many arguments, but the most important is obviously the precancer, you know, return to the precancer state. What the people, they want is just go to the normality, go back to the normality. They want to feel, you know, feel free of disease, and they want to feel a real breast. The people, they want to be normal. And obviously, when you see a picture like this, you can understand that this patient, even they keep the breast, they don't have the normality, because they still they feel a lot of scarring, they feel deformity, and this is not a good result after breast cancer treatment. The patient want daily routine and self-perception. And that is very important. Look at this result. This is an implant breast reconstruction that is quite nice, symmetric, but when you ask the patient say, doctor, it's not perfect because I feel a skin coldness. I have subcutaneous tension. And this, all these things we need to consider to create a good reconstruction. You can imagine what these patients feel when you do this kind of breast reconstruction in your related tissue and you get this medium long-term result, because you must consider that the limitations of the implants are the durability and the non-harmonic evolution, and obviously the symmetry lost. You need to remember that every woman are different. It's not the same, the African, the European, the Latin, and we need to assess the body of the patient. We need to assess the breast, but the body, and not only that, we need to assess even the emotional environment. This is why the first main step is listening to your patient. When you see the techniques, nowadays, we have like two big blocks of the techniques. One, the implant reconstruction, the other one, the autologous tissue. Obviously, in the implant reconstruction, it's more and more important, not the tissue expanded like it was many years ago, the DTI, the direct implant. And in the autologous tissue side, obviously, is the perforated flap techniques are the more important. There are also some complements in reconstruction, like the ADMs, the meshes, the fat grafting. And what is important is all of these things are good. The concept is we need to choose the right technique for every patient. And this is why they are more and more important, this hybrid and combined techniques concept. Why this is the best option for breast reconstruction? Because this is the most similar tissue to the breast. They said the same kind of skin, and the most important, the quality of the fat is exactly the same that the quality of the breast. And that is very important. And nowadays we can know where are the vessels that they are feeding this tissue using the CT angio or the MRI. And then, you know, this kind of surgery is becoming more and more easy. And this is why our menu in breast reconstruction is quite large, the organic menu. You have the abdominal flaps, you have the gluteal flaps, the lumbar flap, the TMG, all the intercostal, the thoracodorsal, the contralateral intermammary flap. You have a long possibility to do and to get the right tissue. The DLP flap is the most standardized. You have several talks. I am not going to describe step by step this technique, obviously. But this is a fantastic flap that allow result like this. And look at these results 17 years after, or 18 years after the mastectomy and the major reconstruction. You can see how beautiful is the evolution of this flap in this body. Obviously, you know, with one, the patient that is in your right side is very easy to do any kind of perforator flap, but on the one that is on the left side is not so easy. So you need to take all your talent and take your all anatomy knowledge and your surgical skill and increase your creativity to get nice results. But now you have technology like the ICG that it helps to you to define perfectly the boundaries of the flap. And then you can know exactly where is the limits of the tissue that you are going to use, and is quite easy. And also the MRI or the CT angio, you can define exactly where are the superficial and deep system. You can do very safe and reliable CA flap like this. That is a flap that we did 20 years ago with this, you know, intraoperative ugly result, but, you know, little by little, the gravity, because at that time we didn't do any kind of fat grafting for refinement, you can get this nice and acceptable result. So the limits on autologous reconstruction, the only limit that you have is your, you know, energy, your creativity, your talent. You can combine DAP and CA flap like in this young lady, and quite skinny that she had this problem after and wrong indication of implant reconstruction. And when we studied abdomen, we realized that the lady had very low septal, deep inferior epigastric perforator, and we use the contralateral superficial system, and then we can get that kind of result combining enough tissue, even in quite skinny patients like this. And then the patient, they can keep the quality of life, and even they can do topless on the Barcelona beach. That is another fantastic tissue to do breast reconstruction in a big old women. You know, the tidal flap that was described by Claudio Grigiani, you can take this amount of tissue. You can imagine an skin island of 26/14, and when you take this kind of tissue, is a huge volume, and then you can use this perforator and you can move all this tissue to the thorax, and you can create a very nice volume and nice shape without no microsurgery. Obviously the dissection is microsurgical dissection, but no microvascular ascomosis. In a very quite short time, you can get this kind of design. Another one, the post-bariatric patients, when they have a lot of tissue, both the axilla, you can take this huge leak up and you can create a nice volume to do an immediate reconstruction like this. And another possibility, another thing to consider is the old women always they have or they need to have the opportunity to do a breast reconstruction with autologous tissue, especially in cases like this. That patient that was 86 years old, she had some osteomyelitis, and then we used the contralateral breast to do a new breast or to do a thorax reconstruction. And this is, in fact, the oldest concept of the breast reconstruction that Bernil described at the end of the 19th century. And that was the concept, just move from one side to the other side, and then you can create, or you can move all this lower pole of the breast basing one perforator, and then doing the propeller method, you can move to that side and you can create this big amount of tissue, and then you can get this a nice result after a few months in a very easy operation, and the lady can keep a very nice quality of life. Patient like this, you know, quite old, diabetic, obese, even when you do the CT angio, you cannot see any deep perforator, but this amount of tissue, this abdomen is leaving from some part, obviously from where? From the superficial system. And then you can do a nice CA flap, even if it's obese, diabetic, and you can create a nice breast like this. Huge breast in a diabetic patient. So the limits of your creativity is your hands and your brain. Another concept that nowadays we are talking is the breast neurotization. This is something that we can use, we can do using these sensitive nerves from these perforators that we are going to use, and then look for an intercostal nerve. You know, now there is some groups like Dusik in Washington or Aldona in Houston doing. But I must tell you that I tried several times. I cannot tell you that there is a big difference with the spontaneous, you know, neurotization of the any other, you know, perforator flap, especially the deep flaps. It means that is an extra four, and especially when you use this very expensive, you know, graft. And I don't know yet if there is make any big difference. But the idea and the concept is nice, you know, to try to provide the best sensation to our flap, and this is something that for sure we need to explore more. When you see the comparison between the breast autologous reconstruction with the implant reconstruction, it's obvious that the autologous tissue in the long-term result, the satisfaction of the patient is much better. But when you see what is happening in the world, you see that, for example, in the US, the implant breast reconstruction is growing and not the autologous tissue. Why? You can find many arguments, but at the end, even if you read the papers that they publish, you realize that the main argument is that at the end is money. It means that the fees when they do implant reconstruction is double that when they do autologous tissue. So sometimes money is the most important thing. But anyway, implant breast reconstruction, autologous reconstruction, we have all kind of women, and we can and we can find indication for any of these techniques. And also you need to consider sometimes when the patient is young and you cannot do autologous tissue and you do an implant reconstruction. A few years later, when the body of these women change, you can replace this implant from autologous tissue. So the most important thing is that they keep that the current concept of the breast reconstruction is dynamic. It means that we need to check and to look for the best technique for the best moment. Obviously, our society, we have the two sides, the very thin, even the anorexic people and the obese people, and we need to find, you know, techniques for everyone. Obviously, the scandals of the implants, like the PAP scandal, the CILIMED, now the all the fears about the LCL, they are putting on the table that we need more safety and the patient satisfaction is important, but we need to consider that obviously the most important thing is the best for the patients. Some big dogmas like the submuscular reconstruction has been broken, and now we realize that, you know, we can do prepectoral reconstruction with a very nice results, with less pain, less animation deformity, less asymmetry, and less discomfort. And this is good, all these kind of frustrations for the patients, this Cleveland cell per patient, we can improve if we do this kind of prepectoral breast reconstruction. And obviously the fat grafting, now that is a very nice tool. I don't know if it's good for a total breast reconstruction, but at least for partial breast reconstruction, it's a wonderful tool that helps to solve these deformities, and it's something very easy that everybody knows how to do. Total breast reconstruction with only fat grafting, some people can do, but in our hands, this is something very difficult to achieve, and you need many times that at the end, I think don't deserve to try. But it's a very nice thing to do in this, you know, implant reconstruction. This lady, you can add some fat and then you can improve the contour. This is why we are moving more and more to this hybrid breast reconstruction with implants, and we can create a nice result. Regarding to the ADMs, what I can tell you that this, the for me, is not any big advantage, at least in this initial concept of this lower pole covering, because they have the same implant limitation, they keep the muscular distortion, and is in another foreign body that can give complication. And this is the only two, you know, clear evidence in ADMs, higher cost and more complications. And this is why we move from this lower pole cover to a better control of the IMF, and at the end it helps to when you do in a prepectoral way to keep the right position of the implant. And at the end, in summary, we can say that we are going more and more to the organic. We are escaping from this allogenic, you know, reconstruction, and this is why even the implant reconstruction is going to this hybrid reconstruction with prepectoral approach, less morbidity, smaller implants, and fat grafting. So the important concept is the organic again, you know, this autologous tissue. Another important point is why we don't include at the same moment that we do the breast reconstruction, the lymphedema reconstruction. This is why we tried to do for many years ago this concept of the total breast anatomy restoration. It means at the same time that the patient need breast reconstruction, we can try to repair the lymphatic system. And you can see here that if you do the right technique, you can achieve an improvement of the lymphatic system and a nice shape of with autologous tissue. But the last step is the prevention. Why we cannot do at the same time, you know, this immediate reconstruction of the lymphatic system, the same like we do with the breast. And this is why we started to use the concept, you know, many years ago, the T-bar technique, 2009, Pocardo described the lympha concept in 2011, and then we put on the table the TILAR technique in 2014, And I am going to explain you very fast the evolution of this TBAR to this TLAR. The total breast anatomy restoration, it was simple, is to do the opposite than the oncological surgeon is doing, putting a breast, vascularized breast, and repair the lymphatic system, putting lymph nodes with a lympholymphatic anastomosis, and that is what we did, the reverse mapping, the mastectomy with the axillary clearance, keeping these afferent, you know, lymphatic vectors from the arm, and then dissecting these lymph nodes and also keeping looking these afferent vessels to the lymph nodes, and then connecting all of this tissue to the thorax and the axilla with double vascularity and with this lympholymphatic anastomosis. That was a fantastic operation with a very nice result, but with some limitations. And these limitations were the time consuming, the complexity, and also because there was a high risk of lymph node desvascularization when you are looking for these afferent vessels to the lymph nodes. And also there were some shadows in how this intranodal LBA derivation is working. For that reason, we decided that technique, it was not probably the one to do as a routine. It was something that it was not easy to be reproducible in every way. And then from the idea of Bocardo, of the lympha technique, we tried to improve, and instead to put, you know, the technique of this sleeve technique, it means a bunch of fat and lymphatics in the vein, we tried to do something much better, that it was following the principles of the Japanese people, this LBA's end-to-end or end-to-side, but in the right way, we moved to this concept of the TILA, the targeted lymphatic axillary repair, that I'm going to show you in a couple of examples. This is a lady with a therapeutic left mastectomy and prophylactic right mastectomy, and with a sentinel biopsy, we plan to do this targeted lymphatic axillary repair if necessary, and I'm going to show you how it's based. We do this reverse mapping with the ICG, and just before to take out this lymph node, we check if this lymph node is or not, you know, getting lympha from the hand, and we can check this in that way. I don't know, now it's not working well, but I need to show this. Yeah, and see here you can see the image from the ICG, and you can see that this lymph node is fluorescent. It means that before to take this lymph node, what we are going to do is to dissect the afferent lymphatic channels, and then at the same level do one lymphovenous anastomosis with these afferent lymphatics in order to keep, you know, the drainage of this arm, and then to avoid to create lymphedema. That is the concept. And then we can do the DIP, bilateral DIP reconstruction with any problem. And another example, that this lady, for example, is quite young and thin lady, that in that patient we tried to do the same, the left therapeutic and the right prophylactic, but we decide to do a DTI, a direct implant with a biological mesh. This is the reverse mapping with the ICG. This is again when we started the section on the axilla. And again, in that case, what we check before to take the sentinel biopsy, and we check with the ICG, and you can see here that this lymph node was blacked because was no fluorescence from them, and it means that you don't need to do anything else. Unfortunately, when we finished the mastectomy, you know, the pathologist sent the result of this sentinel biopsy, and it was positive with some micrometastasis, and then we did the axillary dissection. When you do the axillary dissection, what you try to do is a little bit more distal to the lympha area. We keep some afferent lymphatic channels, and then we do the anastomosis, and you can see here. And okay, then we do the reconstruction with this DTI plus lymph node, and that this is nice to see. This is the angiosity of this lady before the surgery, and you can see this is a completely normal arm with some, you know, fluorescent lines. That this is a lymphatic system. This is the elbow, and this is the lymphatic channel. This is a normal arm. There is no dermal backflow. And what I'm going to show you now, this is the same ICG, but you can see after radiotherapy, because this lady received radiotherapy also on the breast and in the axilla. And what you can see here in this arm after radiotherapy, and you can see how beautiful is working the lymphatic channel. This is, again, the elbow, and you can see how is the transport, and that is a nice proof that when you do this immediate repair with the Tiller system, you can obviously avoid the lymphedema. And this is the result after more than 60 cases, because we have no more than 60 and more than 5 years of follow-up. In all the patients that we have done this technique, there is no lymphedema. And I think that this is the future of the breast reconstruction. This is global vision of the not only the mastectomy, the contour deformity of the breast, also of the lymphatic system. And the new trends on breast reconstruction, we can say that are looking for less morbidity, looking for or doing more immediate and more oncoplastic reconstruction, and looking for the perfect material. And the perfect material, obviously, is the closer and the organic, is like the food, 100% and fresh local products. And I don't know what is going to be the future, but I can tell you that at least the present in breast reconstruction is what I try to summarize in this presentation. I would like to invite you to the next personal best meeting that will be in October of this year, because I hope that all this nightmare of the COVID will be finished. And also, if somebody is interested in learning more about lymphedema surgery, is welcome to do or to apply for this lymphedema research fellowship. Thank you very much, and congratulations for this wonderful, you know, meeting. Thank you very much.